Yeah, but when the official time starts?
Now.
But actually, you don't go until Amy says you're going. So.
4 o'clock?
Yeah.
We can start, yeah? All right. Yeah, welcome to my talk, nice people. I'm glad some even came. Welcome to my talk. Go to considered useful, which of course refers to the famous paper of Edgar Dijkstra. And if you want to know something about this small paper, hear this talk. It's excellent. I'm actually referring to this talk, but actually I'm referring to a tool I wrote, which is named GoTo. I use it for some time. I wrote it in Perl 5, and now I rewrote it in Perl 6, and it was like my first Perl 6 project, which was not just a library, but a real executable, like a complete project. Yeah. Of course, the title is provocation. Yeah. Behind sufficient layers of deniability. I could also say, of course, it is useful because we have it in Perl 6, so it is useful. Yeah. But of course, there is such a thing as positive trolling. Who am I that I give this talk? I'm a long-time lurker in the Perl 6 work, wrote some wiki stuff, some docs, some articles, nowadays some modules, mathematics, and second in preparation. And I gave a lot of talks. Last year, it was at the German Perl workshop, this talk, which I rewrote into two talks in Glasgow, writing a Perl 6 module and releasing a Perl 6 module. So this also is part of writing a project in case, but you want not only in case if you want to release it, but I don't want to duplicate too much, so this part I mostly didn't repeat it in this talk. Yeah. These talks are the slides you can always download from my site, lichtkind.de/Vortrag. There are the video links from all my talks and the PDFs. And the PDFs and video links from this talk will be there too. Yeah. Something I forgot last year's, but who's perfect? This year I gave in Munich at the German Perl workshop this talk, and you will now hear the English version of it. It will largely about high-level stuff because documentation is quite good, and nothing is more boring than reading the documentation. I think you don't came for that in the talk. Yeah. Instead of it, I want to talk about some own thoughts and about stuff I knew, I wished I knew earlier, which would help me to write, make much lesser mistakes, let's say it that way. Yeah. And I think that I can give some noobs ideas so they are head straight in the right direction, so they can make their first Perl 6 project with much less hassle. Some words to the editor, because it is very worth it to use the right editor when writing Perl 6. You can use Vim, you can, of course, Emacs. Langs is not here, good. Atom is quite good. Not all the functions of the plugins work, but UX-wise, Atom is fantastic. Yeah. It is even so fantastic, it doesn't do very, very much like in full-blown IDE, but it does the necessary stuff. And at least in the UX departure, it is much a lot of better than comma, I would say. But the best thing is still is to use comma by Jonathan Worthington, which is UI-wise little bit stuck in the 90s. A little bit, you know, it has a little 90s flavor still. The search bar is very small, like it is. There are modern UI guidelines that that you have better visual feedback, and there are many more things. Like in the search bar, if you select the text, it gets invisible, and it doesn't say you how many searches you found. It gives you no feedback, if at all, searches very low key feedback. That is it's much better in Atom with that. Like I said, I gave like a half an hour talk. I had last semester UX class. We talked about Atom. It was many details, and so I know what I'm talking about. But yeah, it's not this talking. But we can later. Yeah. But other than that, it is the best IDE for Perl 6. And even some guy like me, who even doesn't use as many features, would highly recommend it. Yeah. For instance, there is on the comma page this sentence, rich and detailed Perl 6 highlighting. I would say it's simply the best Perl 6 highlighting. It goes in so many details which can catch your mistakes even while you do it. Yeah, and that's most useful, that's at least to me, more useful than many other things. Just to do one little example to show you what I mean. This is a regular expression in Perl 6. Of course, you know the M operator, matching. I don't have to tell you that, you're at the Perl conference. If you put the S behind, that's the same thing as M colon S. And this means that you with matching with six base. If you say MD, then it might be a self-made operator, but it's nothing that Perl 6 actually knows unless you created this operator. Comma makes with that, this is original comma highlighting, which is on the slide. It's as soon as I change the S, it changes colors, and I knew I did something with that. I tested all the other editors, no one else did it. Just as one example. It was not the only example I tested, but now you get a flavor for it. Of course, it is easy to search for all the keywords, yeah, or look at the braces, but when it goes more into the details of the syntax, comma is much superior. Also, magnitudes. All right, enough praising. You might ask what I actually mean with Goto. Goto, like I said, is a tool which lives on my command line. It is somewhat released on GitHub, but I have still to complete it. I thought I'm able to the conference, but I will. I got in the pain to switching on my own machine to the Perl 6 version, so I'm motivated to finish it. It's a little bit like CD, and it's like CD, because the nice thing, CD is easy to type, because on the keyboard, CD is close to each other, same as with GT, like Goto, and it's like a long distance jump. I have always a set of projects, they are sitting in some directory, and switching that CD. This is sometimes a hassle, so I make the long distance jumps with maybe go to my project, most important project, it's like go to 123, I say go to git h2 and I'm in the directory. It's very useful. I have even shortcuts, like for instance gt is of course go to the development directory of go to, of course. Yep. Like I said, I have integer, also numerical and string shortcuts, and it gives me like a little bit of project overview what I'm currently working on, because only that directory interests me and are in in the current list which is displayed. Like I said, I have other projects, but not today. They are secret. Of course, I have to, in my bash script, an alias for that, so that's actually working. Maybe there's a more intelligent way. I didn't found it yet. The Perl script writes into a file called last choice, the directory, and I read it out with cat and going into it. Because I didn't know how my Perl script would go into a directory, and I stay still in the directory after the program stopped running. Yeah. All right. When I started to develop GoTo, I looked at modules per 6.org at some modules, and these were some of the interesting ones I wanted to use. In the end, I used these, for instance, Yamlish, because it's faster, and I think because YAML can't even properly write YAML, no? till today, and Yamlish can. NCurse is still in the future, I don't know about that, but like I said, the static table was not good enough because my table gets updated because, of course, the tool is able to add new directory. Yeah? If you're in an interesting directory where you make, now you know no new project, you say GoTo, it shows you the old directory it saved, and then you say A for add, and it adds the current directory. For that, I need a dynamic table, and that's why I have, in my script, a data layer, which that will be my next module I will release on POSIX modules. And for that, of course, I created my own data type to get a nice separation, and I don't get crammed everything into the main script. And speaking of data types, now we are getting into the realm of POSIX goodies. Like I said, this module, table dynamic, it's a sort of abstraction. It does all the data work. And I can it also use as a type in signatures and stuff. Yeah. But you don't have to. You can start slow with subtypes. And I find it a nice thing to start thinking about your project. Which kinds of data will actually appear? Which data type will I need? Yeah. And so then can you think about which subsets you will need, and you can then use these subsets in your signatures, and so you get the good out of POSIX. Because why use POSIX if not of the features? You could POS5 instead, you know. To make this project wide, you have a subtype PM6. It's just 1 hour ago checked with Tatsik. You define your subsets. It is minimal. Example positive in you can fill in, and then in all your project files you can use this module, and now in signatures use your type. Yep. And can you read it?
Yes.
Good.
Finally.
Yeah. Yeah. But this is, of course, a beginning. If you're getting more experience, of course, you're getting more into types. And I would even suggest to learn a little bit about types is the first thing you should do when learning about POSIX. There are, of course, objects, and POSIX makes it easy to forget about that you're actually handling about objects. But you are free. Unless Java, for instance, you're free to create object or not. But you are not free if you want to handle data or not. Because if you don't handle data, you're not programming. Yes, and so you will actually deal with types. And you have to at least know something. That's why I encourage go into documentation at language type system. This should be your first read. In my not so humble opinion. Like I said, types are classes, So you have to make your own data types by getting your own classes. You can of course inherit from string or array, but I suggest you make like OOP per usage, not per inheritance, so you don't get all the methods, but you are free to implement a method or not, and so you have an API which makes sense and don't have some weird methods around that do weird stuff just because you had to override something. Yeah. Of course, we all know that, it's just the basics. If the class goes all the file, then it's a unit, and you use the class. Yeah. Actually, you don't even need a new method because it's all yes. In case you ask why is the name Billy Barton, many other people asked it themselves the same question. Of course you can, if you want, make a new method and still call bless. That's still possible. And bless calls the build sub method, and you have that too. And actually, that is a thing. The reason why I'm telling you that this is one of the stones I fall upon when I started using that. That you know, like the parameters are handled. You can omit the build method. You can omit new. So you can omit one or the other. You can omit both. You can even implement. You can implement both. If you, for instance, just omit the new method, just the named arguments get handled and passed through. Yeah? So you don't have to worry. So you might ask why we have a new method, why we have a build method. Nothing easier than that. Of course, if we are here, then we have no object before that. Let's create the object. Now we have an object and we can actually do stuff with that. This is one part, and the other part is after n, don't forget to return the object, yeah? Now it's your responsibility. And the other part is there are attributes with a dot and attributes with exclamation part. That's a private things. The private ones you can assign in the sub method and the public ones in the new and not vice versa. Yeah? This is one reason. The other reason is new can be inherited, the build not, so you want to know, decide what to put in what. Now, to maybe my main point. How much we still have? All right. These are the real goodies of Perl 6. Like I said, if you want to write a small script, you can omit all that, but I think the great fun of using Perl 6 lies in that features, and you should use them heavily. Thank you. So we're very good. The multi-method dispatch. Why I should use that? Here a little example from my data layer, data table dynamic. In the table we have rows. These are the data sets. Of course, every row stands for a directory which is stored, yeah, which has a shortcut and a time created, how many times I visited. So I can sort it along these properties and have different views of the table. And when I want to move a row in the table, I can either say I want that number move to that number, or I can like a query like with a pair, like for instance a shortcut which has that name, and this row I want to move in that line. Yep. But these two do actually the same stuff, and Perl 6 does the sorting for me, what is what, and the code gets much clearer when everything has its place where you put it, when the signature actually give you a sense of overview, where is what. Yeah, not only return value and some other things we will come to. The code is much more pleasant. But it has also another effect which is deeper and which made me thinking, and which is one of the main points I want to share with you, is because you have multi-method dispatch, actually you can put functionality which you before maybe laid on several function, now you can put into one. And this is why, because when you have positional parameter, it's much so you can, you want to have as least as possible, but if you have a name parameter, it's much clearer what the call does. So it's has much less danger in it if you put more functionality into the into a method, because you always can see what you're actually asking for because you have these named parameters. And another nice thing is these Boolean, because you of course you have some of the directories can archive, because these are projects you're not currently working on, but you want to save them. And for instance, if you have the table content with the archive, you have the Boolean when it's positive. So you, it even spares you the hassle of some magic constants, checks the compiler at compile time for you. Or at least as possible. Sometimes, of course, it's runtime generated. And yeah, because this is how you call it, no? Per default, you don't have the archive, but if you say, I want the archive, you get the table content sorted by position archive. Yeah? It's very clear to read, and my point is, when you do that stuff and more functionality goes bundled together into one method names, yes, that's what I just said. You get what I try to coin subname spaces. So you get like the package gets organized it is a quite different feel how to organize the API than Perl 5. It's another way of thinking about that, and that's why you have to, I won't say prepare to it, but it's better not to stumble into, but know that there is this possibility and make full usage from the beginning on. And that's another thing with signatures. What really gave me a headache when I started, especially reading signatures, was these guys. I mean, the documentation is so good that just if you type the smiley into it, it gives you, in the search box, you see a colon D with signature trait. You might be scared of the name signature trait. Is that what I'm looking on? Is there something else? It is just make sure that you give a defined value. For instance, if you have at position method, so in my matrix module, you have to provide that method so you can use the syntax. The thing is, I actually could do that. This is an integer object, an undefined. And I could pass that because this undefined is still an integer. So if I wouldn't put the D behind that, it will still be accepted. And you can like poke the system. But when I say this, I want a defined, and I just put an undefined in it, then I get an error. And of course you want to do that. And that these so-called type objects that are in truth undefined, that is a problem which can cause me also some head scratches because in my table, what I showed you, these the cells, they are of course also typed, and I do type checking when new data comes into the table, and of course which type it is, I have also lay in some variables, so I have something I can check it against, but this variable is actually the value of that variable is undefined. Even I have something it which is value to a value has value to me. This can be very tricky. Yes.
I think the thing to add is that profile has undefined undef, right?
Yeah.
And it's one undefined value for all the types. That didn't really work out with Perl 6 because Perl 6 cares too much about each type, and undef would have to be of all of the types.
Yeah.
So that's why we have the type object. So int values have this undefined int.
Yeah. It makes sense, but even to me. But you have to know it.
Yeah.
It can shoot you badly if you expect them.
Yeah, you need to care about those happy smiles.
Yeah, and that's why I mentioned them. And that was one of the biggest beginner obstacles to me. Yeah, and this is that's why I'm talking about. Of course, if we talk about this smiley, we have also talked about this smiley. You see the big difference, yeah. Here's another colon. Yep, this is another trap. Of course, used like in my matrix module, it just means that the caller, the mathematics module, the method is, okay, it's a builder, but the method is actually is square. If you want to know, this matrix is a square matrix. The caller has to be a defined. Yeah. So I showed you on the slide before. Here you have an int type object. That's undefined. And if I have an undefined matrix object, like mathematics, then I can't ask, is it a square matrix? It demands, it has to be a defined object. This is also important if you write your new method. If you only want get new called by an undefined, if you, for instance, permit that an actually object can still call new, then you can forbid that in the signature with that. Clear so far? Thank you. All right. Last tip, we have the thing fail, which was not common in Perl 5, which I highly recommend. It's actually not that easy to set up all catching all the right errors on the right place, because if you trigger an exception with fail, then the next method higher up the hierarchy has to catch it. If not, it goes away. Maybe you don't even want to set up when you just start to program Perl 6, use fail and it doesn't matter. Then it's almost like auto-die, almost. Auto-die does a lot more. But it is a good way with not much hassle to start with exceptions, and you can start to use them and write them in appropriate places, and when your script is written, then can you catch the errors in a sophisticated way. All right. Speaking of failures, some mistakes I made. We have no auto flattening, which was tripped me up badly. This is, right people, this is one parameter. Yeah? We are not more in Perl 5. Another thing is, if I'm using a map and want to pass the result of map on. In Perl 5 I thought, oh yeah, of course, that's an array, put that. No, we are in Perl 6, this is a sequence. A sequence is not an array. So you want to have a list, and we had on the end put dot list on it. Yeah. Tripped me up many times. I know the stuff symptom. Yeah, I'm a good Perl 5 programmer. I can do that. Yeah. Of course, it's a small thing, but it trips. Yeah, it is. The nice thing is the stars always like the whole array in Scala index. It gives you the number of indices. So -1 gives you last one. If you're used to Perl 5 and during typing you're not even thinking about it, bam, you did it again. Yeah? Equivalent is another such thing, because equal converts, because types matter, like I said, converts into numeric context, and if you want to compare objects, no matter what type they are, you use that. Yeah, and speaking of, I know what I'm doing. When you use stuff you think you know, like grab map, things you know in sleep, the Perl 6 version can do more. For instance, here if you use colon K, it just filters for you the keys and gives you just. I'm grabbing about pairs. I'm comparing the pair, but I just want to return the keys. So because it's something you do quite often, I just colon K and it returns me the key and the code gets much cleaner. Yeah, this is another thing. If you have, where you just have the slight feeling, you need this quite often. Look into documentation. There's all the functions, what you know from Perl 5 are much, not all, but most of them are mightier than in Perl 5. So it's still worth to look it up. Time? Sorry. What? Oh. So we have question time. I didn't have to hurry. Yeah. Okay. Then, coming to my last slides, try to use the real thing. Don't try to use some magic number or some weird construct which is tried and works under Perl 5. Try to express the idea you have. I mean, you use Perl 6. You use Perl 6 to have fun, to do it the right way, to do it the clean way. Then try to formulate it that way. Yeah. For instance, we have real hashes. Yeah. That means that are collections of real pairs. Yeah. And like I said, if you want to get a hash out of it at the end, you have it to say it. Types matter. Of course, you can do it the same with that operator, but that's a little bit more hassle compared with Perl 5. Another thing is, keys of hashes are really strings. Yeah. Even when you know the keys of your this is wrong. I can't stand have a mistake. Sorry, but of course. If you have keys, even when you know the keys are numbers, you can't treat them like numbers. Only if they are cool, also that's a funny name of an object type where you can treat numbers as strings and strings as number. Yeah, so common type. So you have still the easy of handling of Perl 5, still in Perl 6, yeah, of Scala values. This type is called name cool. Like I'm cool with it. Yeah, whatever. Give me numbers. Give me strings. Like we know it with Perl 5. Yeah. But the keys of hashes are real strings. They are not cool, and that's why you have to know. It tripped me also more than one way up. Yes.
You can also declare hashes to have a key of a certain type.
Yes. Oh,
yeah,
thanks.
It's really cool.
Yeah, good pun. All right, last slide. I was really way too fast. Sorry, people. I thought I'm running against the clock. What? Yes. Good. Thank you. Infinite. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, real-time debugging. And because one of the features of my data table is some values you can't change. They are just triggered. They are just like dates. You don't supposed to write, but they just have to protocol which date something is created or which date it is used last time. Yes. And so you have there values which tell me how much more this cell can be written. And these cells have, of course, a zero. They forbid to be written. And other cells, per default, of course, have infinity, because they can be written in infinite amount of time. Of course, each time I write a cell, I count this down one. But because we're here in Perl 6 and everything is nice like it should to be, when I count down infinity, I'm still at infinity, so it all works. Yeah. So I don't have to use some weird special constant number and have to care if something is overflowing and get some max int. I can write it down how to mean it. And this could be exemplary for many things. I just want to get the idea through. Try to express the concept. Don't do some magic stuff you're used from Perl 5. Yes?
But you understand? Oh, you saw that I wanted to say something.
It looked like.
Yes.
Half a sentence.
I was waiting for the right moment, but yeah. Here's an interesting historical fact. Larry wanted infinitive to be of all the types.
Yeah.
So you can compare it to anyone, and infinity would always be bigger.
Yeah.
But, so it could be bigger than any string or bigger than any custom enum.
Yeah.
Yeah. Int is a known in Perl 6 and only a known.
Yeah.
You can't do that cool thing where you compare it against anything.
Yeah.
It just doesn't work out with the types.
Yep. Like speaking of weird constants, we have a real true value. Yeah. We have a real false and we have a real true. Of course, in numerical context, they evaluate to 0 and 1 like you're used to it, so you don't feel much a difference. But we're dealing with a real type here against with these two expressions. That's why I meant types are intrinsically important to Perl 6, and that's why I said these are really the starting point to study this stuff. All right, that's all I got. Question time. But how do you know the name you can call them?
You read their source code.
Oh, you cook to each variable name it is.
Yeah. You can use named arguments even on positional parameters. It's quite convenient sometimes. So even if it's someone else's API and they didn't prefer named parameters like you do, you can still use named arguments.
I embarrass myself enough. I accidentally used that, actually. Okay. When I think about that, yeah. Without noticing, yeah. Thank you.
Just as a comment, that's kind of where people say Perl 6 is too big, but you can progressively learn the language.
Yes.
And it still works for you.
Yeah.
That's a good counter argument.
I also don't think it is too big. It has the subset which you can start 6 with is rather small, and there are many things beginners do which are easier, or a lot of easier, in Perl 6 than in Perl 5. I gave other talks on that, and that's why I didn't mention them here, but it's like slurping a file without file handle. Yes, for instance, you say, I want this file, I get the content, nothing else. Yeah.
Sorry, I was wrong about the named arguments. It was true some years ago, but that was removed. Because the names of the positionals are not meant to be part of the API, the public API.
Yeah, it feels
so
cleaner.
That doesn't work, actually. Too bad.
When was it active?
I remember it working around 2014.
Yeah, I was around then, so. I would have tried it in half an hour and it would be sad, so I'm sad now.
Yeah,
yes?
Your slides about
which?
New and built. You can just pass it.
I think I said that, but what do you exactly want to say?
Okay.
The parameters get passed automatically through. Mm-hmm. That was my understanding. You can omit one or the other, depending on what you want to do. Yes.
Also, kind of funny. Your title was Real Infinity on one of the slides, and there's actually a type real in Perl.
Yeah.
Of which infinity is a member, because
Yeah.
I
actually know. Thank you. It's good addition. Yes.
By the way, this equation holds in Perl 5 as well if you write into the poles.
Where did you find?
When I'm applying the string, it's probably or it used to be platform dependent somehow. So Windows, it had this hash prepended to the name, but I guess it was fixed.
All right. Okay. Thank you.